Welcome on campus, episode 7. We're off to Trentino to host this year's Winter Universiade in December to see how preparations are going for the event. We hear from the director of the Winter Universiade, Milan Augustine. In part 2, we'll focus on an Olympic and Winter Universiade champion, the speed skater from Italy, Matteo Nesi. And we've got a report on the Winter Universiade legacy for Tarvisio that hosted the event back in 2003. In part 3, we've got an update on the progress of the Kazan 2013 Universiade flame as it heads across the world. And before closing this month's episode, we meet Polish biathlete Tomasz Sikora. The 2013 edition of the Winter Universiade will be held in the northern Italian province of Trentino and its breathtaking Dolomite Mountains. After the withdrawal of Maribor's candidacy in April of 2012, the locality offered to host this year's edition in December due to the Nordic Skiing World Championships in Val d'Affiem next February. Giving the province such a big responsibility with such a short time frame is a real mark of trust from the FISU. Trentino Organising Committee President Sergio Annesi explained why.
Well,
Sergio says Trentino has lots of sports facilities built over the years and used to host normal sporting activities as well as huge sporting events. So Trentino has the infrastructure in the area to be able to host any kind of event it wants in winter sports. And that is really our strength.
Questa sua rete sul territorio di infrastrutture per poter ospitare qualsiasi tipo di evento legato a attività sportiva invernale.
Well, created immediately after the announcement by the FISU that their province will hold the Winter Universiade, the organising committee was formed along with Trento University members and they started the hard work 6 months ago. Secretary General Filippo Basinella explains what has happened and how they focused on the assets. Well, Filippo says there are already a lot of local organising committees that are able to organise events in their own disciplines, but the big challenge was to get all of those people to work together as a network. Started to do that in the last few months. As he says, they built the car, now they need to put the fuel in it and start it up. Let's have a look at the venues then for 2013, starting with the most famous area in central southern Europe for Nordic skiing, Lago di Tesero in Val d'Affiemme. To learn more about the existing facilities and the big event experience in these disciplines, we meet Franco Nunes, the first ever Italian to win an Olympic medal in Nordic skiing back in 1968 in Grenoble, France. In cross country, the 30K trial, he insisted on the big Nordic skiing tradition in Trentino and the expertise of organising important events. Well, there is a quality and a quantity of those very high-level events for sure. I would say that Val d'Affiemme, as we speak, is one of the cradles of Nordic skiing across the whole of the world. Among those events was the Tour de Ski final leg in Lago di Tesero, Val d'Affiemme, on the 5th and 6th of January, where the Universiade Nordic Skiing competitions will be held. It's also where the Nordic Skiing World Championships will be held in a few weeks for the third time in 22 years.
Well,
back to Franco, it's never happened before, he says, in any venue in the world, that the Nordic Skiing World Championships will be held in the same spot for three times in 22 years, even in Scandinavia. And that shows what the International Federation thinks of us. It has great confidence in our capacity to organise big events. Piero De Gondens says we've become the reference for Central Europe. There are so many people that look to us. We're so happy about it. And we have here the winner of the Tour de Ski, Justina Kowalczuk, who, by the way, has just been named the best female athlete of 2012 by the FISU. So we are preparing well for this great event, the World Universiade. Well, after her fourth consecutive win of the Tour de Ski, a first for a cross-country skier, Justina Kowalczuk was very happy to come back to Val d'Affiemme for the big events.
This is one of my love areas in the world. Is I like this track here and all the sunshine and everything. Yeah, I'm so happy that here will be the World Championships.
Time to leave Val d'Affiemme and head to another venue, Pagine and Baselga di Pine. Pagine will host the women's ice hockey tournament, but also curling in the Palagiazzo, the ice stadium. Baselga di Pine will also host the speed skating competitions. And we had a special guest to tell us all about that, Matteo Nesi.
Trentino è molto legato al pattinaggio perché a Basilea di
Matteo says Trentino is very much linked with speed skating. Because for Sergio de Pugna, there is a great covered track, 1,000 meter altitude. And there's always been a huge tradition of speed skaters. We had the world champion, of course, Roberto Siga. The Italian team has won at the Olympics, and with me and my teammates. So a high level of sport has always been part of Trentino. Let's go to Val di Fassa now, where the Alpine skiing events will take place. Apart from the ice stadium at Canazze, which will host the final match of the men's ice hockey tournament, Val di Fassa also counts existing facilities that hosted Italian and European Alpine skiing championships. The Alloc ski run in Pozzo di Fassa, where the slalom and the giant slalom races will be held, will also host combined slalom races at Passo San Pellegrino. The individual Super G and combined races will also guarantee great excitement. And last but one venue to discover is Monte Bondone, which will host the snowboard competitions, board across, half pipe and parallel slalom, as well as freestyle ski cross and halfpipe competitions. And the last venue, which is surrounded by the whole province of Trentino, is Trento. The biggest city in the area became renowned back in the 16th century with the famous Council of Trento. The figure skating and short track events, as well as the opening and closing ceremonies, will take place in Trento. And here's a local Olympic champion to tell us all about that. Christian Zotti says for us this place represents the heart of our province. Everything was born in this place. The passion for winter sports especially was also born here in Trento. We have mountains surrounding the city, passionate people, and there isn't anybody here that hasn't put skis on their feet at some point. So to be here and to start here, it seems very natural. In Trento, all the facilities are here, and the facilities of Trento University especially, which is more involved in the organisation of the Universiade. The vice president of the organising committee is also an active member of the university. He explains why. Paolo says the Universiade is for sure a huge opportunity to take this sports project to a higher level, because sport is not only about sports activities in our free time, but it is also a huge opportunity to discover new research areas, to make innovations, to develop products and to improve didactics towards students. And there's a lot been done for practice of sports in the local area with students in the province. The University Sports Centre of Trento organises lots of events and activities in that perspective, and the president tells us about that. Well, within the international classification, there will be a special one for the Italian students. The first of those rankings will be crowned Italian academic champion, and it's very important because the students that will be on the podium will automatically qualify for the Universiade that will be held in December in Trentino. Well, the Trentino region has a very rich history in winter sports and a big sports event organisation in every discipline. Now all those experiences have to merge to become a single and competitive organisation. Well, back to Christian, he says, I think we need to do just that. It's the icing on the cake. Trentino has always held international sports events of a great level. The Winter Universiade is the pinnacle for any sports land. Then went to Lausanne to meet with the director of the Winter Universiade, Milan Augustin, who told us about how confident he is for this year's edition.
Yes, Trentino can do it. And why? Because they organized already 5 Winter Universiade. First was in 1966 in Sestriere, and the last one in 2007 in Torino, just 1 year after the Olympic Games in. Trentino is the big challenge, but Trentino is something more. As we found new host, we had to give them time, you know. And this December date will be also a challenge for us in terms of how many countries will participate. What will be the real, I have to say, focus of National University Sports Federation, National Sports Federation, because they can use this Universiade as a maybe pre-selection of the athletes, as a qualification round for athletes for Olympic Games, because the Universiade will be organized just 2 months prior to the Winter Olympic Games in Sochi.
As mentioned, the focus is on Trentino, and there's only one remaining venue to be built, Monte Bondone, for the freestyle skiing and snowboarding. Despite the lack of time, the Trentino organizing committee is succeeding.
I think that in terms of some kind of connection and to give the and to deliver to city something after the Universiade, even like the start of this legacy, would be great for us, what we can really come afterwards and to see how the Monte Bondone was developed. They have chosen some kind of innovative system of green mobility for citizens of the Trento connecting with Monte Bondone. And this is something what they really focus on in post events.
The last issue in organizing an event at such short notice is the athlete's village.
What we have agreed between FISU and organizing committee in Trentino, that it will be some kind of athlete's village, but it will be around 50 hotels.
Watch the coming episodes of Campus to learn about the 2013 Winter Universiade updates. Stay tuned to Eurosport as Campus is back after the break with a focus on Matteo Nesi from Italy, the Olympic champion in speed skating, and a report on the legacy of the 21st Winter Universiade in Tarvisio, host city of the 2003 edition. Passago le Pine is one of the venues of the Trentino Winter Universiade, as you know. We met Olympic champion that lives there and trains in the Palazzo that will host, amongst others, the speed skating events. Matteo Nesi won two team pursuit golds in Turin, one in the 2006 Olympics, the other a year later at the Winter Universiade. Well, it's more than strange. I'd say it was funny. I was very young. I was just 21, 22 years of age. So I have to say, I wasn't really realizing what was happening to me. Both at the Olympics and the Winter Universiade, I lived those experiences day by day. But in Innsbruck in 2005, Turin 2006, 2007, they are experiences you cannot forget. Well, Matteo competed in the 2005 Winter Universiade in Innsbruck as well, but what is his best memory? Well, I'm more particularly linked to those of 2007 because it was just 1 year after the Olympics. After we won the gold medal in the Olympics, we managed to win the same event in the Universiade. So it was a bit like living the experience of the Olympics again, but in a totally different atmosphere. At the Universiade, there was a lot less stress, a lot less pressure, and really we just wanted to enjoy ourselves as well. And we did it. And I have to say, it was great. After missing out at Vancouver 2010, Matteo, 28, has a last challenge to be part of the Italian delegation at the Sochi Olympics in 2014. Next year will be the Olympic year, and it will be the year of qualifications for the Olympic Games. So it will be very important. There will be World Cup events in which I will aim at the individual qualification, but also the team qualification, because I'm convinced that Italy can have a great Olympics when it comes to Sochi. I'm sure of that. So Trentino is about to host the 2013 edition of the Winter Universiade, and the organising committee is directed by his father, Sergio. But he told us what he thinks about students competing at a high level in sport.
Well,
to combine studies to a high level and sport is a bit of an innovation, because people know that studying and practicing at a high level is very, very hard in sport, but it is possible. So it's a great message to spread out. To participate in the Universiade is a unique experience, because you meet with not only athletes, but student athletes, so you can share a lot of good things with one another. And for those who participate in the Winter Universiade hoping to be part of the best of their discipline someday, and those who hesitate between sport and studies, there's advice from the champion. Well, to be a student athlete, I can recommend to not let that go, never let it go, because sports, well, it's a beautiful thing. But when you do it when you're young, you also have to see beyond that. You have to try and have an education to go to university, to move on, because sports practice comes to an end at some point, and life is long. So you can always do sports when you're young and study afterwards, but my advice is to do both at the same time. The students that will compete in the Universiade, I wish them to have fun, and the most possible fun, respecting the rules, respecting their rivals, respecting themselves, but always looking forward. And that is the main point. Now, they have 11 months to prepare for the 2013 Winter Universiade from the 11th to the 21st of December in Trentino, where they will try to have fun, but also perform. We're in northern Italy now, at the border of Austria and Slovenia, in the Val Canale. The city of Tarvisio extends between the Carnic Alps and the Caravan Ranges in the north and the Julian Alps in the south. Back in 2003, Tarvisio was the host city for the 21st Winter Universiade. 10 years later, what is the legacy of the Winter Universiade to Tarvisio? And what kind of place was it before organising the event? Well, Renato Calatoni says Tarvisio has always been a fairly touristic ski resort with Monte Lasari. It's a place of pilgrimage for people. You can find here Italians, Austrians and Slovenians. And it's been a regular venue for alpine skiing over the years. So a lot had to be done, though, for the FASU's requirements for the city of Tarvisio. It had to raise huge funds, helped by the region of Friuli Venezia Giulia, in order to go from a small ski resort to an international winter sports competition venue. Maurizio says regarding the sports facilities, ski lifts, ice stadiums, ski jumping hills, cross-country tracks, curling and club, there's been a remarkable investment. And all those investments helped Tarvisio increase its skiing area standard, but also extended its influence over the area, being surrounded by Slovenia and Austria, making it the centre of winter sports in the province. Just in Tarvisio, we have 38 kilometres of alpine skiing slopes, not mentioning the Nordic skiing tracks nearby in Selenovia. There are another 35 kilometres, and 10 kilometres from Tarvisio, we are connected with Slovenia, which means you can spend the day skiing in both Italy and Slovenia. And it's a frontier area with no real boundaries. Naturally, the higher standards and larger skiing area change the tourist statistics. The cost of a day's skiing is one of the most attractive in the region, even compared to their foreign neighbours. What's the impact then on the tourism figures since 2003? Well, it has completely changed. It made Tarvisio famous. We have a lot of tourists coming here to the area. If we compare the statistics from the 90s, we've increased it by 150% to our present-day figures in the district. So everything was born in Tarvisio 2003. But the legacy is not only about figures and facilities. The combination of the two made it possible for Tarvisio to host other high-level winter sports competitions. Thanks also to the Winter Universiade, some forgotten disciplines were revived. Well, the 2003 Winter Universiade was a great springboard for other sports and events. We had a lot of other events held here since then, the most important being the Women's Alpine Skiing World Cup Leg. And we've been hosting that for 3 years now. We entered this network with high satisfaction, so that will be a major result from that. But we mustn't forget the other disciplines. We hosted the Nordic Skiing Juniors and the Under 23 World Championships in 2007 in ice hockey. The team of Ponteba has been revived and is now playing in Serie 1 in Italy. And fair results as well in club. The province of Pordenone, where curling has been revived, has started to do really well. So overall, we have this great return to sports at the highest level. The feeling that we have now, 10 years after the Universiade, is that we have made a lot of initiatives about different winter sports. They have been born or reborn. And it means that the interest of the public and also the interest of the students to practice these sports has just grown bigger and bigger. The flame of the Winter Universiade still burns in Tarvisio 10 years after the city hosted the event, and it will remain for local people and organisers a tremendous memory as much as a real springboard to excellence. Up next in campus, some news about Kazan 2013's Universiade flame and the future of a great champion. And we focus on a biathlon star, Thomas Sikora. Set off, the boat which carries the 2013 Kazan Universiade flame is travelling the world and continues on its way. Let's remind ourselves, 2013 or 2013 torchbearers will visit 54 cities and 50 student centres on five continents, covering 150,000 kilometres in less than a year. The relay will see the involvement of over 1.5 million students around the globe. There's been early reports suggesting that the two-time Olympic champion Yevgenia Kanyeva has quit the sport, but apparently she's not planning to retire just yet, and she said herself that she hasn't decided on her future in rhythmic gymnastics. Apparently her words and actions were simply misinterpreted by the people responsible for posting the information on the Federation's website. Well, the 22-year-old Russian star, who became the first woman to win two Olympic rhythmic gymnastics all-round titles, needs at least 6 months to fully recuperate from her injuries if she's to compete in the 2013 World Championships in Kiev in August. The big champion, Tomasz Sikora, the icon of Polish biathlon, decided to end his career last season.
Dlaczego tak się stało?
I decided to stop. Well, last season was very hard for me, not only physically, but first of all mentally, because it was hard to accept some 50th or 60th places. I rarely won any World Cup points, so having analysed my performances when I came back home from Kanty-Mansijsk, I came to the conclusion that I could hardly compete at the highest level any longer.
No jest już mi bardzo ciężko rywalizować na najwyższym poziomie,
Sikora took part in six Olympic Games, 15 World Championships, won a Crystal Globe in the sprint in 2006, beating Ariane Biondalen, and was second in the overall World Cup in 2009, and he's also won six gold medals at Winter Universiade.
No, myślę, że zawsze jest przyjemnie, gdy...
I think it's always a pleasure to win and to be in a Universiade, in a World Championships or in a Polish Championships. I just like to win. But you always aim to give your best and to get the best results possible, to get medals, and Universiade as such is regarded as an important competition with those medals on the line. So winning made me happy and it made me satisfied. Well, for the athletes, Universiades are indeed a unique experience. World Cups, well, you come for a couple of days. It's a maximum, maybe a week-long stay. But the Universiade takes up more time, and we compete in all distances. In this respect, it is closer to a World Championships or a Winter Olympics than to a World Cup event. It's close to the Olympics because you have all the winter sports there at the Universiade too, and all the athletes are alongside you. Well, most of the time Universiade is a springboard to a career. Tomasz competed after becoming a world champion already. He felt important pressure, not only because he was expected to win, but because the Universiade was at home.
Yes,
I did particularly feel it because it was a difficult period of time for me. I trained an awful lot, but I had a rather unfortunate dip in my performance. So these were difficult years around 2001 for the Universiade. And true, the expectations were huge. But such was also my joy after having won the medals. The Universiade was an opportunity to rebuild my position and my mental strength. His new job now, though, is to coach the young Polish athletes. He succeeded in a sport and a university career, and he now shares that experience with the young college students. Well, Lukasz Planina says, I think it's good that he has become a coach. Young guys can learn an awful lot from Tomasz Sikora. I think Polish young biathletes will definitely be good under his wings. Karolina Bartoszyńska says, for sure, all of us young biathletes can learn a lot from such an experienced coach. We needed a coach, and I'm very happy that we have Tomasz Sikora, because he can use his experience for our day-to-day practice.
Powiem szczerze, że bardzo dobrze.
And Thomas says, I feel very good.
Na grupę osób, która
I have an ambitious and hard-working group of people around me.
Nad sobą.
Naturally, Rome is not going to be built in one day. And now I'm getting acquainted with all of my biathletes. So this season is kind of an introduction for all of us. The team was formed back in August in the middle of preparation period. So really we could not practice as much as I would like to. But having seen all the athletes, I'm sure that the next season will be much better for us.
Także no nie można zawsze zrealizować tego wszystkiego, co by się chciało.
Tomasz Sikora as coach, the Polish team will certainly be a team to follow for the future Winter Universiade. Good luck to Tomasz. That's it for today, but coming up on the next episodes of Campus, you'll learn more about the athletes that we've decided to follow to the Summer Universiade in Kazan. Bye for now.